Good morning, everyone. Very warm welcome to you. My apologies for starting just slightly late this morning. Before we do start, though, just to welcome, to let you know a couple of things. We're going to use incense today. We've turned the fire alarms off, and hopefully we won't have a repeat of last week's fire alarm going off. But just in case, if the alarm does go off, we will have to evacuate. Please remain in your seats when the alarm goes off and allow the welcome team to lead you out from the back. So just to let you know that, they'll lead you out the main doors and maybe the side door as well. We have the young people at the front of the church, so if you've got a young person who is with you, it's always better for them to see be at the front because they can see what's going on rather than looking at the back of somebody's head. So there are places here at the front for them. Or what else is going on? If the parents have asked for a space for children in case, you know, they make a lot of noise and parents sometimes want to go out, that being the case, the hall has the video set up for parents. The children can sit on this side as well. Or is it, okay, the first 3 rows, that's fine. Good. I think that's about it. Let's just close our eyes and be still as we prepare for the beginning of Mass.
Thank you.
A very warm welcome to you all to St. Mary's Cathedral, especially of you who are visiting. I know there's some people who are visiting from the States who just joined us, some also from Africa and other places. So a very warm welcome to you who are new here. One of the things we're trying to do is to grow as a community and as a community of love. And part of the way we do that is by praying for one another. And we do that in a very specific way here. We have prayer partners. And so the idea is before Mass begins, we find somebody near us that we don't know, ask their name, and commit ourselves to pray for that person. So nothing touchy-feely, just turn to somebody near you, ask their name, and commit yourself to pray for that person. Right. Remind me of your name again. Kobe, sorry, Kobe, my name is Mary's terrible, so I'm going to pray for you. Is that okay? Can you pray for me? In fact, I'll pray for you as well. What's your name? Aoife. So if you pray for me, and I'll pray for the two of you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, today we keep the third Sunday of ordinary time. And this Sunday, the Holy Father a few years ago asked that it be a day when we remember how God has spoken to us, how God has given us his word in the person of his Son above all, but also in Scripture. And so today, that's why we have on the table there a copy of the lectionary, the book that is used for the readings at Mass, to remind us of God's presence to us in his word. And after the homily, those of you who read regularly here at Mass are invited to come forward for a special blessing. That is after the homily. So let us begin our Mass by opening our heart to God's word, attuning our ears to what he has to say for us, to us, and begin by asking for his mercy. Have mercy on us, O Lord.
For we have sinned against you.
Show us, O Lord, your mercy.
And grant us your salvation.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Christe eleison.
Christe eleison.
Kyrie eleison. Glory to God in the highest.
And on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father,
Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, direct our actions according to your good pleasure, that in the name of your beloved Son, we may abound in good works. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. In days past, the Lord humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in days to come, he will confer glory on the way of the sea on the far side of Jordan, province of the nations. The people that walked in darkness has seen a great light. On those who live in a land of deep shadow, a light has shone. You have made their gladness greater. You have made their joy increase. They rejoice in your presence as men rejoice at harvest time, as men are happy when they are dividing the spoils. For the yoke that was weighing on him, the bar across his shoulders, the rod of his oppressor, these you break as on the day of Midian. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is my light.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. I appeal to you, brothers, for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ, to make up the differences between you, and instead of disagreeing among yourselves, to be united again in your belief and practice. From what Chloe's people have been telling me, my dear brothers, it is clear that there are serious differences among you. What I mean are all these slogans that you have, like, I am for Paul, I am from Apollos, I am for Cephas, I am for Christ. Has Christ been parceled out? Was it Paul that was crucified for you? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the good news, and not to preach that in the terms of philosophy in which the crucifixion of Christ cannot be expressed. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Hearing that John had been arrested, Jesus went back to Galilee, and leaving Nazareth, he went and settled in Capernaum, a lakeside town on the borders of Zebulun and Naphtali. In this way, the prophecy of Isaiah was to be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, way of the sea on the far side of the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people that lived in darkness have seen a great light. On those who dwell in the land of shadow of death, a light has dawned. From that moment, Jesus began his preaching with the message, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." And as he was walking by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who was called Peter, and his brother Andrew. They were making a cast in the lake with their net, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." And they left their nets at once and followed him. Going on from there, he saw another pair of brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in their boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets, and he called them. At once, leaving the boat and their father, they followed him. He went round the whole of Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing all kinds of diseases and sickness among the people. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, in 2019, not so long ago, Pope Francis declared that this Sunday, the third Sunday of ordinary time, be the Sunday of the Word of God. Every Sunday is a Sunday of the Word of God, is it not? But it's good sometimes just to stand back. We have a Trinity Sunday. Every Sunday is Trinity Sunday, we can say. But it's good sometimes to stand back and reflect on these things. And the Pope's hope for this Sunday is it be a day when we celebrate, when we study or reflect upon, and when we share or spread the Word of God. And why this Sunday, you might wonder? Well, I can think of a few reasons. Because every year on this Sunday, we begin reading the Gospel of the year, A, B, C, Matthew, Mark, Luke, this year A, this year Matthew. We begin on the Sundays of ordinary time reading the particular Gospel of the year in sequence, from beginning to end. Not absolutely everything in it, but highlights. And so this year, as I say, we are reading the Gospel of Matthew. So if you're thinking, oh, it'd be nice to read something, I'd like to read a bit of scripture, well, why not choose the Gospel of Matthew? On this Sunday, too, the Gospels, A, B, and C, and we just heard it in form A, show our Lord beginning his public mission. And how does he begin it? By speaking, by preaching, by proclaiming the Word of God. So, to the people of Galilee, up there in the north of the Holy Land, he says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand. Those are his first public words in this gospel. And then, passing by the Lake of Galilee, he sees the two pairs of brothers, Peter and Andrew, James and John, and he says, come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Personal words to those four. It's good to think, isn't it, that for the first 30 years of our Lord's life, what we call his hidden life, we only have one exchange where Jesus speaks. Be a good question for a quiz, you know. Well, it is when he is 12 years old, we remember, and leaves his parents, disappears his parents, goes into the temple, and they find him, having looked for him with great distress. And he says, well, why were you distressed? Did you not know that I must be about my Father's business? That's the only word we have from the first 30 years of Jesus' life. He didn't say anything to the shepherds. He didn't say anything to the wise men. He didn't say anything to Simeon and Anna. Well, he was a baby, of course. But Still, perhaps it's good for us to remember this, that these first 30 years, of course, when he was a carpenter, of course he talked to his people, of course he talked to Mary and Joseph and the others, but it's not recorded. So perhaps it's a good reminder for us that we don't have to talk all the time, that there can be some space for silence in our lives. But today, this Sunday, you remember he has been baptized in the River Jordan, and the Holy Spirit came upon him in the form of a dove. The Holy Spirit, we might say, kick-started the public mission of Jesus. He moved from being a private person, a young carpenter in a village, to being a public person on the stage of his people, the stage of history. At Christmas, he entered our world from the water, the amniotic fluid of his mother. And at his baptism, 30 years later, he came into the world in another way, through the water of the Jordan. A man now, no longer a baby or a child or a young man. Now the Word made flesh becomes Word, begins to speak. Jesus' voice is heard in public, and the light of that Word starts to shine in the darkness. So maybe that's one reason, is to take us back to this explosion of the Word of God from the lips of Jesus that happened in Galilee in fulfillment of Isaiah's prophecy. But there's another reason, too, perhaps, because often this Sunday falls, maybe it always falls, I don't know, but certainly does this year, during the week of prayer for Christian unity. Now, we may have different takes, to some extent, on the Bible from some of our Christian friends of other denominations, and we recognize seven more books, extra books, in the Old Testament, the so-called deuterocanonical books, than do the Christians who spring from the Reformation. But substantially, we and other Christians hold the same Bible in our hands, and we hear and we learn the same words and the same stories. And so the Bible can be a bridge of friendship. It has been used in the past as a club with which we beat each other, you know, and that still goes on a bit. But really, the Bible should be a bridge of friendship and connection between Christians. Every year at this time, too, here's another thought, comes Holocaust Memorial Day. It falls on the 27th of January, which is next Friday this year. It's the anniversary of the liberation of the concentration camp at Auschwitz-Birkenau. And so we think of the Jewish people, and with them we share the Old Testament, and we want that too to be a bridge of friendship, connection between us. Well, when Christ came out of the waters of the Jordan, fired by the Holy Spirit, he began to speak God's words. And when we go into the baptismal waters, one of the graces that comes to us when we are baptized is the opening of the ear of our hearts, so that we can hear and speak God's word in a new way. Before a baptism, you may remember this, the celebrant touches the two ears, whether it's a child or whether it's an adult, touches the two ears of the candidate, the catechumen, and the lips, and says, Ephphatha, that is, be opened, Aramaic, that you may profess the faith you hear, to the praise and glory of God. We need new ears to hear the word of God. You know, it's said, isn't it, that the first sense after touch, I suppose, the first sense to open in the womb, in the childhood womb, is the sense of hearing. So that when the baby is born, it recognizes its mother's voice. It's only heard it from inside, as it were. Now it hears it from outside, but it recognizes that voice. Its ear is opened. And then they say, important to remember, that when we're dying, often hearing is the last sense to go. So we should be very careful what we say. Someone may be passing away before our eyes and we think they're away, as it were, or they're out of it, but they can still hear. So hearing, so fundamental. And through the Holy Spirit, that God opens this inner ear, this ear of the heart, St. Benedict calls it, so that we can hear God's word, so that we can tune into it. So we're asked to celebrate, to think about, and to share God's word. Well, if there is anyone in the Bible who did that, surely it is Our Lady. You know, she is the great hearer of the word. When she sings her Magnificat, it's just a tissue, really, of echoes, quotations, allusions from the Old Testament. Mary knew her scriptures. She'd heard them read. They'd become part of her. And so when she wants to praise God, all these phrases from the Old Testament come to her lips. And we know how when the shepherds brought the message from the angel, when Jesus at 12 said those strange words to Mary and Joseph, "Don't you know I must be about my Father's business?" We know she kept those words. That was how she celebrated them. She kept them, she remembered, and she pondered on them. You know, she was trying to understand them. She couldn't understand who this son of hers was, but she worked away at it in her heart, turning over what was said about him and what he said. And then, in due time, perhaps after Pentecost, she shared what she had heard and understood. How else do we know the story of the Annunciation, the Visitation, the details of the birth of Jesus? How else do we know these things? It must be from Mary. Must be that Mary passed this on to the early Christian community, passed it on to St. Luke. Then we know at the foot of the cross, she was entrusted with John, and John took her to his home. So she went and lived with the Apostle John. Well, what did they talk about? You know, what did they do of an evening? Well, of course, they reflected back on the life of Jesus. And the Gospel of John has this deep, deep insight into who Jesus is as the Son of God, the Word of God, come from the Father. Who did he get that from? Who did he get that from? Can only have been Mary, surely. So, there she did what the Holy Father is asking us today. She's the great model and pattern for this. So today, we've set up the lectionary to show honor to the lectionary. Today, too, as I say, there'll be a special blessing. Now, I'd just like to say this. Okay, here's a phrase, just launch a phrase out. The culture of the word. I think that's what we want as Christian people, to have a culture of the word of God. Each of us, each of our families, each of our parishes. It'd be wonderful if we really cultivated the word of God, grew it
in our hearts and in our communities. We already do, but to do it even more. So some folk, you know, download, well, you can download anything really, but you can download the New Testament, download the Psalms, or maybe best, simplest, the readings of the day, even if you're not going to Mass during a week. There are those readings in the blank moments. Look at them. Think of God as sort of texting us each day through the readings that there are at Mass, and we can have those at our fingertips. It's a lovely thing when a family, and some families manage this, or a group of friends get together during the week and read the readings of the following Sunday together and share their thoughts about them. And if we do that, it's a fact of experience, if you do that, when you come and hear the readings, they don't just go over your head because you've already thought about them. And suddenly you may even get new insight into them, which you hadn't had when you were all discussing, because this is a living word. This is the Lord speaking to us. But talking of families, I remember once giving a class, and their religion class in, it was at St. Joseph's School, I think it was P6, and it was about the conversion of St. Paul. And we remember how our Lord, when he appears to St. Paul outside Damascus, he said, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And so I asked the children, well, what does that mean? Because Jesus was in heaven. Paul wasn't persecuting Jesus. Paul, Saul, as he then was, he was doing dreadful things to Christians. But what does it mean? How can Jesus say you are persecuting me? And one girl put up her hand and said, it's because he said, whatever you do to the least of these little ones, you do it to me. Well, I thought, well done. You know, she should have had a free holiday in the Bahamas or something. I mean, really, that was fantastic. How did she do that? Because in her family, the scriptures were read. That's why that girl knew the answer to that question. It wasn't just something you heard once in a week on a Sunday, but that the word of God was alive in that family. And so there she was. The Lord speaks to us here in the liturgy of the word. And sometimes, as we know, he speaks to us very individually, very directly, as he spoke to Peter and Andrew. A phrase in the Bible, something that our Lord says, or Isaiah, or St. Paul, or St. John, anywhere, can hit home to us, pierce the heart, sharp and sweet all at once, and it cuts through the mist in the mind. Most of the time we're sort of wandering around in the mist, really, but it lights up the darkness, maybe resolves a difficulty that we have. It gives us a sense of how the Lord is really guiding us. Sometimes these are words that just fit one passing situation we're in, but sometimes they're for the whole of life. Saint Charles de Foucault said, in the Bible, it's such a huge thing, it's such a big forest. There is a word put by God for each individual human being, maybe, which will just light up the path. And there's something then we can pass that on to others. We all say things that we wish we hadn't, you know. We all say a lot of useless words, and we say some bad words, unfortunately. And at our worst, we can be just like a bad noise, really, you know, moaning for Scotland. But with the culture of the word, there is another possibility, a wonderful possibility, that we ourselves, each of us, become a word of God, because each of us is a word of God. each of us becomes a word of God for others and to his glory. So let us do that. Let us try to grow the word in our heart. Ask Mary's help to do that. And now, in gratitude for their service and to bless them in this good work of reading in public, may I invite, unless you're terribly shy, may I invite those of you who read regularly to come forward, and there's a very simple blessing. Okay, that would be good. Thank you. Select group. Okay. There may be some others here, but anyway, you can still take the blessing to yourself. But okay. Now, I'm not instituting you as lectors. I've got to say that. There is an instituted ministry of lectors, but that's another issue. But this is a blessing. Everlasting God, when he read in the synagogue at Nazareth, your son proclaimed the good news of salvation for which he would give up his life. Bless these readers as they proclaim your words of life. Strengthen their faith that they may read with conviction and boldness and put into practice what they read through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us stand and profess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Let us call upon the Almighty Father who sent his Son to preach the coming of the kingdom. In confidence, we offer our prayers before the throne of the Most High.
For the church, and especially for all entrusted with proclaiming the word of God, that as we celebrate this Sunday of the word of God, they may renew their commitment to being at the service of the word. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For an authentic love of Scripture, that our listening and our reading, our study and our prayer may guide us out of darkness and into the bright revelation of Christ. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For Christian unity, that the octave of Christian unity we celebrate might be a means for the fulfillment of the Lord's desire that they may all be one, as the Father and the Son are one. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
for all who live on the borderlands of our society, that they may be brought into the hearts of our communities and be welcomed as our true brothers and sisters. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For all who are sick and in need of healing, especially Pauline Marsh, Lucinda Morris, and infant Lucas Morris, Jennifer Hayes, Jed Farrell, and Amelda Reed, that the word of life proclaimed in Scripture may revive their souls and strengthen their bodies. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For all who have died recently, especially Ina Ross, who died last night, Kathleen Golding, James Sutherland, Maureen McGrotty, Mary Edge, Jean Johnson, Charlie Phillips, Patricia Jackson, Louis Danila Wika Ohua, and William Morris, that they may live in the house of the Lord and savor his sweetness in the sanctuary of heaven. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For all our personal intentions and those of our prayer partners, we pray in silence. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us. Almighty Father, may the petitions of your church be pleasing in your sight, for we make them with trust in your love and goodness through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We are now going to have our offertory collection, and if you would like to support the mission of the church through financial donations, we are delighted you're able to do that. One of the ways, if you're a UK taxpayer, you'll find at the end of the bench a white envelope in which you can put your giving, your gift. If you could fill out the envelope and seal it, that way we can claim gift aid, which really is a big, big help for us as a parish. But thank you very much for anything you do give to support the mission of the church.
Lord, you have come to the sea.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
The Lord accepts our sacrifice for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all the church.
Accept our offerings, O Lord, we pray, and in sanctifying them, grant that they may profit us for salvation through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For through his paschal mystery, he accomplished the marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, summoning us to the glory of being now called a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for your own possession, to proclaim everywhere your mighty works, for you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and choirs of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Holy,
indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant, Francis our Pope and Hugh our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him,
O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
At the Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Should we say something about communion?
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Let your faces not be abashed.
We are just going to move to Holy Communion. And if you remember last week, the bishop was speaking about how we receive communion with reverence. So just a reminder that two of the signs of reverence that we give before we receive communion is the bow is the most common one. And we would bow before we receive communion. In the hands, flat hands again, if you would please. Or if you're going to use your tongue, please open your mouth and do stick your tongue out. You can also genuflect, and if you do genuflect, then to genuflect behind the person who is receiving communion, if you could do that, please. We'll have the chalices on either side of either pillar. If you wish to receive from the chalice, please do so. We'll also have a chalice by the font. Please make sure that you have safely gripped the chalice before before letting go when you give it back to the minister of Holy Communion, and only take it a small sip. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that receiving the grace by which you bring us to new life, we may always glory in your gift through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. It's wonderful to have had you here with us this morning and now this afternoon. So, just a couple of items to bring to your attention. Bishop Hugh was mentioning that this is the week of Christian unity. And the tradition here in Aberdeen is that the three cathedrals, we've got an Episcopal cathedral, and we've got this cathedral, and we've got St. Macca's Cathedral in Old Aberdeen. The three congregations would meet and pray together. It's called the Three Cathedrals Service during the week of Christian unity. So that takes place this evening at 6 p.m. and Bishop Hugh will be preaching the homily that evening. If you want to go along to that, you're all invited. It's great to gather together with our other brothers and sisters in Christ and to show support as well. What else about that? Yeah, that's good. Okay, next week we have a second collection, and the second collection is for lepra. Lepra is, they've been here before a number of years ago, and lepra supports those who are suffering from leprosy. So there is a cure for leprosy. I think those of you who have been receiving the bulletin will have seen information we've put on about lepra, videos we put about lepra, and the great work they're doing to help people suffering from this awful disease. So next week, second collection, just to give you a heads up, so either you come armed or with your cards, because there is a, I know you wanted to put more inside the collection. You didn't have that much cash this morning, and you wanted to put more. I know that's the case. So if you want to give more, you can do that. There's a contactless device at the back of the church. So what else is going on? Our bookshop is open after Mass, so you can buy rosaries and all sorts of books on the faith, Bibles and such like. They are there. And so please do make use of that. What else? Our thanks to our welcome team for welcoming people in. And if you're looking for a way to serve, and we should all be looking for a way to serve as disciples of Jesus Christ, one of the ways you can do that is by joining the welcome team. And you can speak to Diego at the back of the church. You can look around, see Diego. He's waving there with one hand in the air. Fantastic. That's Diego. Speak to him. And the choir also are looking for members. They sang beautifully once again today. Thank you very much. So you can speak to Sheila. Sheila's waving madly at the back of the, there she is, at the choir loft. Fantastic. Okay, and afterwards you're all invited to join us for tea, coffee. They've got cakes and biscuits and chocolate stuff and all that sort of thing through the hall, through those double doors at the end of Mass. What am I missing? Sister Francesca's here. What a privilege. So she's going to tell us a little bit about what's happening with the young adults. She leads a young adult ministry. Sister.
Good afternoon, everybody. So just a couple of things. So as Father said, I help run a young adult group here at the cathedral for any young adults 18 plus. So we meet on Thursday evenings from 7 p.m. to about 9 p.m. And this week, we are privileged to be able to have a holy hour. So what better way to spend your Thursday evening than here in the church with the Lord? So that will start at 7 p.m., from 7 to 8 p.m. If you're not exactly sure what to do during adoration, don't worry. There will be music and guided reflections throughout. Also, some space for silence if you just want to listen to the Lord, to just be with the Lord. And then at 8 o'clock, for those who want, we'll gather at the back of the church and then go somewhere for some social time. So you'll have your time with the Lord, love of God, time with each other, love of neighbor, the two greatest commandments, as our Lord says. So if you have any questions about that or about the group, please feel free to see me after Mass. The second thing is, so this summer in Lisbon, Portugal, there will be something called World Youth Day, which is an international gathering of young Catholics ages 16 to 35 with Pope Francis. So if you're keen on seeing the Pope in Portugal and also having a little pilgrimage to Fatima, Do feel free to speak to me. There's a few spaces left with the diocesan group. There's a group from the Diocese of Aberdeen going, and there are a few spaces left. So it's a great opportunity to experience the church throughout the world. Bishop Hugh will be there as well. So do feel free, if you have any questions about that, to speak to me after Mass. Thank you, and God bless.
Fantastic. Thank you, Sister. Great to have you with us. If you're a mother with small children, there's a baby and toddlers group on Tuesdays between 10 and 12. You can come anytime during that time, and you can meet all the other mothers there and support one another in your faith as well. So just an encouragement for that too. Fantastic. Thank you very much again for listening.
Excuse me, can I just add, for the last hymn, we'll sing verses 1, 2, 3 without the chorus and add the chorus just at the end. Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Go forth. The Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray together the synodal prayer. Sorry. We stand before you, Holy Spirit, as we gather together in your name, with you alone to guide us. Make yourself at home in our hearts. Teach us the way we must go and how we are to pursue it. We are weak and sinful. Do not let us promote disorder. Do not let ignorance lead us down the wrong path, nor partiality influence our actions. Let us find in you our unity, so that we may journey together to eternal life, and not stray from the way of truth and what is right. All this we ask of you, who are at work in every place and time, in the communion of the Father and the Son, forever and ever. Amen.